All right, folks, we've hit 11 o'clock. It's time to begin the webinar. I'd like to welcome you. This is Alan Jay, Acting Director of Outreach and Engagement at the ZOA. Title of this webinar is The Relationship Between Israel, the PA, and Gaza, Where We Are Now and Where We're Headed. It's going to be co-hosted by ZOA National Board Chair Mark Levenson, and the head of TPS's Arab Desk, Lieutenant Colonel Baruch Yedid. I'd like to welcome you to this latest installment of ZOA's rather extensive virtual programming. To date, we have done several programs featuring natural president of ZOA, Mort Klein, ambassadors Danny Danone, and our ZOA campus professionals. We've been offering a weekly book club featuring renowned authors, and we've offered educational programming called ZOA Israel on the Map, and This Land is Our Land. There's much more to come, so please pay close attention to your ZOA emails and visit our website and Facebook pages often. The Zionist Organization of America was founded in 1897 and has been at the forefront of pro-Israel and pro-Jewish advocacy for more than 120 years. Through our Center for Law and Justice, Department of Government Relations, and ZOA campus, in the halls of Congress, in the media, and in your neighborhood, ZOA shares truth and facts that support Israel's right to be and remain a sovereign Jewish state, including Judea and Samaria, with Jerusalem as her undivided capital, and with the right to defend herself whenever necessary. Today, we're presenting the second installment in a three-part series co-sponsored by ZOA and TPS Israel. In the first installment, ZOA National President Mort Klein and TPS founder and CEO Amos Eyal introduced ZOA and TPS to our combined audience. I'll introduce ZOA Board Chair Mark Levenson, who will speak first, and will then introduce our featured guest speaker, Lieutenant Colonel Baruch Yedid. Mr. Levenson will manage a Q&A session at the end of the presentation. Also on the line is Chana Oz, who will provide English language support if necessary. Please keep your microphones on mute during the presentation. We will ask you to open your mics later if you have questions. Mark Levenson is the co-chair of the Sales and Cummins and Gross Real Estate Department and chair of the Real Estate Transaction Practice Group. Mr. Levenson also chairs the firm's Israel Business Practice Group. Mark is a longstanding member of the firm's management committee and is the chairman of the New Jersey Israel Commission. Mr. Levenson is national board chair of the Zionist Organization of America, and he is a member of the executive committee. Mark played a critical leadership role in drafting and enactment of New Jersey's 2016 anti-boycott, divestment, and sanctions legislation, and continues to speak out and write on New Jersey and anti-BDS legislation. Mark has traveled to Israel more than 100 times and has led or chaired numerous political, trade, and economic missions to Israel. Mark was active for many years in American Friends of Likud, AIPAC, and Brandeis University Alumni Association. Mark most recently was appointed by President Donald Trump to serve as a member of the U.S. Commission for the Preservation of America's Heritage Abroad, and I had the distinct pleasure and honor of working directly with Mark and learning from him when he stepped in this past winter to lead the ZOA coalition to the most successful WZC election in our history, strengthening our voice by doubling our representation on that important body. I give the program now over to one of the most influential individuals in the pro-Israel, pro-Jewish arena. Mark, the program is yours.
Thank you, Alan, and thank you also, Natalie. It's delightful as ZOA board chair to work with such talented individuals as Alan and Natalie, and it's really, especially in these terrible times of this pandemic, it's great to have folks that are really working so hard for our cause. So thank you, Alan, and thank you, Natalie. Today is, I hope everyone's doing well. I hope everyone's family is safe and sound, and that you had as, I'll say, as enjoyable a Shabbat as possible under the circumstances that we're all living under. And hopefully, as we just recently said at the Pesach Seder, Shana Baba Yerushalayim. It's my delight to be here and introduce TPA today and Lieutenant Colonel Baruch Yedid. Just before we do, I want to just mention a word or two about ZOA. You're on this webinar because you are a pro-ZOA, pro-Israel advocate, and that's why you're here, and we appreciate that. If you've been following the Jewish news at all lately, You'd see ZOA and also specifically Mort Klein in the headlines. There's been quite a kerfuffle over the last few days, or even really going back 10 days, with respect to the recent announcement of the Conference of Presidents nominee for the incoming chair of the conference. And ZOA, as well as a number of other organizations, had some very significant and has some very significant concerns with that. You can go online, Google it. You'll see it on Jewish Insider. You'll see it elsewhere. We issued a very comprehensive 7-page letter that kind of set forth in very specific detail with background our concern with the Conference of Presidents nomination of the former chair of HIAS to be the chair of the conference. And Mort and I have been very significantly engaged in that the last 10 days. Yesterday was probably 14 hours on it. Motzei Shabbat was probably 6. And if you read the articles and you'll watch this story as it has unfolded, you'll see ZOA is at the forefront on many, many issues of concern to those in the center right. ZOA leads the fight. ZOA leads the battle. We're effective. We get out there. It's not without cost. We get attacked quite a bit. You have to be on your game fully all the time to be there, but ZOA is there, and that's why we hope you're on this webinar and you're watching what we're doing, and obviously we want you all to be contributors to ZOA. It is a very tough period of time with this pandemic in terms of our donor base and our revenues with challenges abound, so we certainly want you to keep us at the forefront. ZOA will continue these webinars. We'll mention a few upcoming programs at the end of this webinar, but we hope that you'll continue to watch us, engage with us, reach out to us if you want to volunteer, become part of our effort. There are many areas that we engage in, and we're more than delighted to involve you in them. Alan could be your first point of contact since he's on this webinar with us, and then we'll certainly take it from there. And so again, I want to thank you all for being with us. Let me tell you why I'm so excited with TPS. When Mort and I were in Israel on our recent VIP Solidarity mission, we had the privilege and pleasure, I think most folks either know or should know, that ZOA is really the only major organization that spends significant time in Yehuda and Shomron on its Israel trips. And we did that again this trip. And one of our last days there, we were invited to meet with TPS. Now, TPS, you'll hear a little bit about it from Baruch, but candidly, the way I would describe it in its easiest fashion, we all know the troubles we have with the media, both in America, both in Israel, and throughout the world. The media, to be charitable, is really not necessarily a centrist-based media. It is frankly frequently left of center and oftentimes worse. And that's just a factual statement. It's not a biased statement. And so we have challenges left and right. Israel has challenges left and right. Jews in America and worldwide have challenges left and right. So when I met TPS over in Israel, I immediately fell in love with them because they are trying to get out the story that we ZOA want to tell, that you want to tell. It's a very tough story because it's tough to get to. You have strong issues with putting outside. You have a lot of issues with putting out our point of view and our issues. And without the evidentiary background, the photographs, the stories that tell that story, it's really very, very difficult to get that message out there. So we met TPS in Israel one of our last days there. We came back to America, and literally we came back to America from our ZOA trip really as about a week before the pandemic started. I did happen to meet with the co-founder of TPS, who I frankly had met in Israel, but we met in my office, and we said, you know, we got to work together. ZOA and TPS have got to work together because we're not only the same team, but what is they're accomplishing. So we had one webinar last week with TPS. This is a second one. We'll have more in the future. But we ZOA are a big, big proponent of them, and you should be also. Let me introduce Baruch, and Baruch will tell you a little more about TPS and also the Arab desk that he runs. So Lieutenant Colonel Baruch Yedid is the head of TPS's Arab desk. He is the top investigator in Israel media today. He served for over 30 years in the Israeli military and security services. He's fluent in Arabic. He is renowned for his expertise in Arab and Palestinian affairs. Baruch has a BA in Middle East Affairs from Bar-Ilan, and he graduated with honors from the IDF Command College. And it's not true that he had a walk-on role on Fauda, but you might think that when we get done with this program. It's my pleasure and honor to introduce Baruch Yedid to speak to us, and Baruch, take it away, and we'll do Q&A afterwards. Thank you.
Okay, so good evening from Jerusalem, from Anatot. חנה, אנחנו נדבר בעברית עם תרגום שלך לאנגלית. אולי תרצי להסביר להם מילה וחצי בעניין הזה?
We are going to be speaking in Hebrew with translation into English. I would like to just quickly say that Baruch is our expert on the Arab affairs and Palestinian affairs, and I think you're really going to enjoy what he says. Let me just get ready to get started.
בבקשה.
אוקיי.
אוקיי, אז אנחנו נדבר היום על השינויים בתוך הזירה הפלסטינית במהלך משבר הקורונה. אני רוצה להקדים ולומר שמה שנציג לכם היום מבוסס על מקורות בתוך הרשות הפלסטינית, בתוך החמאס, ועל ההיכרות הממושכת שיש לנו עם המערכת הפלסטינית.
What we are going to speak about today is based on his knowledge and his interactions with the security forces of the Palestinian Authority and other bodies.
טוב, אנחנו נמצאים בערך בחודש השני למשבר הקורונה, וניתן להגיד כבר בשלב הזה שאנחנו למעשה מתכוננים לקראת משבר רחב מול גורמי הכוח בצד הפלסטיני, גם הרשות הפלסטינית, גם הפתח וגם החמאס.
We are going into the second month of the coronavirus crisis, and we are preparing for that with the various security services. Hold on one moment. Let me just give Baruch a quick call because I...
אוקיי.
אתה יכול לדבר בעברית? באנגלית אולי קצת?
אני אדבר גם באנגלית, כן.
אוקיי.
אוקיי. אוקיי, so before starting going deep, I would like to emphasize some main terms very important to our next meeting. Palestinian Authority. Palestinian Authority, this is the head of the Palestinian system in Judea, Samaria, and in Gaza. Although that Gaza is now occupied by the Hamas, Gaza Strip was stolen by the Hamas militant group on 2007. But the Palestinian Authority, this is the official body, the official groups that dealing with the Palestinian society in Judea and Samaria, PA, Palestinian Authority. Palestinian Authority is a new regime. It was based by the PLO after the Oslo Agreement since 1994 ahead. And by the Oslo Agreement, PLO established the Palestinian Authority. You should know that Palestinian Authority is something that should be changed with the time. This is something temporary, unlike the PLO, because the PLO for now, this is the only legitimate a representative of the Palestinian people, known by the UN, known by the international community. This is the PLO. This is the PLO is higher than the Palestinian Authority. Number three, Fatah. Fatah is the biggest organization, the biggest group in the PLO. 99% of the Palestinian Authority official, civilians or a military group, are based on the Fatah group. Fatah is no longer a terrorist group by the Israel point of view, because we signed an agreement with the Fatah. You know, Abu Mazen, he is the head of the Palestinian Authority. He is the head of the PLO, and he also the head of the Fatah. And Israel is not considered Fatah as a terror group. Although that some groups in Fatah, especially in Gaza, like the Al-Aqsa Martyrs, are part of the Fatah. Although that Marwan Barghouti, the head of the Fatah, the head of the Tanzim, Tanzim mean organization, this Marwan Barghouti, he is the head of the Fatah, is now in jail for five life sentence and another 40 years, because he has dozens of killing attacks against Israeli and Jews. So this is about the bodies, Palestinian Authority, PLO, and Fatah. Area A, B, and C. Oslo Agreement divided the Judea and Samaria territory to three areas. Area A, this is under the full control of the Palestinian Authority, civilians matters, and also the some security responsibility. For now, Israel cannot go inside Area A without coordinating with the Palestinian Authority. I can tell you that Israel, after the Intifada of 2000, Israel has the decision to go inside Palestinian Authority, inside to Area A, in order to neutral or to control the terror group. But by the agreement, Area A is belong fully controlled by Palestinian Authority. Area called Type B. Type B means that Palestinian Authority has only civilians authorities to deal with the people in those villages, but the PA has no possibility to act by the military group without getting a special permit for the Israelis. And C, this is most important, area called C. These are the settlements or the other territories in Palestine, Judea and Samaria, outside of the Palestinian control. Ofra, Beit El, Gush Etzion, Maale Adumim, Anatot, where I live, this is part of Area C. Palestinians should not go to Area C, but in about 5-10 minutes, I will tell you how they use the coronavirus crisis in order to bypass this agreement called Oslo Agreement in order to act in Area C. Next slide, Hannah, please. How is my English? Is okay? Okay, so for now, Palestinian Authority can control and to avoid the massive outbreak of the corona. For now, they have 495 sick people. Four of them had died. 60% of the Palestinian sick people, the corona people, are from the area of Jerusalem, the north Ramallah, the south Bethlehem, in the middle Jerusalem. This is the metropolitan of the Palestinian Authority. 60% of the people got sick by the corona are from this area. Palestinian Authority, for now, they conduct only 28,000 of corona checks in order to map or to monitor the spread of the coronavirus. You know, Israel is now dealing with about 30,000 checks daily. So Palestinians, after 2 months, conduct only less than 30,000 checks in the Palestinian Authority. Why I mention it? Because I would like you to know that all the data, all the details, all what we know about the spread of the virus in the Palestinian Authority, in Judea and Samaria, based on a very narrow map or search, and we should take in consideration that this is not the real truth. This is not the real situation. So for now, Palestinian can avoid the massive outbreak, but they, and I say also Israel, they are now under the preparation in order to face the massive outbreak. I think it's something could be, can be, in about weeks or a month. And this something will change the situation. In when I was on the military, on the intelligence, we call it the Kav Hamashve. Hannah, maybe you'll translate it to English. This is the...
It's like the breaking point. It's like the breaking point.
This is the tipping point. The reality. But this is very something very important for you to know. Palestinian in Hamas in Gaza and in Ramallah with the group of Abu Mazen, they know that they are going to face a massive outbreak, and they should take some measure and steps in order to face this crisis. One of the main points, one of the main phenomena of what Palestinians are doing these days is the massive incitement against Israel, IDF soldiers and the settlers. Why do so? Because Palestinians want the people, their people, to know in the day of the outbreak, they would like to point on Israel and say, we are now getting this massive outbreak because of those Israelis, because they are not allowed us to work in East Jerusalem, because they are doing with biological war, because they are doing with ethnic cleaning, because they are opening the gates in order to let Palestinian workers from Israel to go back to the West Bank in order to infect our population. And that's why Mohammed Shtayyeh, the Prime Minister of Palestinian Authority, said at least 5 times that he saw the IDF soldier spitting on cars in order to infect the Palestinian population. This is a most anti-Semitic or ethnic or incitement efforts of the Palestinian. I know them for about 32 years. I think this is one of the peak points of the Palestinian incitement. Now, you have to know also that now Israeli and maybe USA, but now Israeli seems to be, not for me, to the Palestinian people, in the high rank or the official of the Palestinian people, Israel seems to be the most close safe net, Reshet Bitachon, the most available. Hannah Muratishari.
Safety net, that's great, safety net.
The most, the most available safety net for us, for the Palestinian, Israel so far, give the Palestinian $120 million in order to conduct with to deal with the virus. Now look at this: Palestinian now asking Israel to get $500 million of shekels every month for 6 months.
And half milliard is half a billion shekels.
500 million. 500 million shekel every month for 6 months in order to be able to deal with the coronavirus. Why they say 500 million shekels? Because this is the all the taxes that Palestinians should collect every month. And now they say to Israel, I want you to give me this sum of the money, whether I did or didn't collect it from my people. So now Palestinians are asking for safety net for Israeli government, parallel to this vicious incitement against settlers, Israeli soldiers, and the Israeli government. Maybe we'll go to the next slide, Hannah, please. Okay, now. For now, for about 2 months, Palestinian Authority supported by the Israeli security forces and the Israeli civil ministers in order to pass through this crisis. Israel gave them dozens of breathing machines, defibrillators and other medical equipment with the corona mask. Israeli soldiers took some sadnaot workout. Yes, Sahana? Workout.
Workshops. They did some workshops.
More than 10 workshops to the Palestinian doctor, even in the Judea and Samaria, even in the Hamas, in the border, in Erez passage.
They were training the doctors in these workshops. Continue.
Yes. By doctors from Sheba, from Tel HaShomer, from Hadassah. Doctors from Israel went to Jericho, to the military academy of the Palestinian forces in order to train them how to deal with the coronavirus. More than this, Israel now giving the workers, the Palestinian workers in Israel, Israel now giving them the salary directly, not through the banks, not through the employees, in order to support the Palestinian people. So if now Palestinian is going to work in Tel Aviv, Israeli army is will give him the guarantee that you will get your money, if not from the people in Tel Aviv, but also from the Israeli government. This all in order to support Palestinian authority. Another slide, Hannah. Yeah. Now, but Palestinian as Palestinians, they are now preparing to another session of clashes or conflict with Israel. One of the measures they are taking is to send back the Fatah groups to the street. Now you have to know that there is a big conflict between the Hamas, the Islamic extreme movement, and the Fatah, the national extreme movement. And every Palestinian should be support of the Hamas or supporter of the Fatah and Abu Mazen. For many years, Hamas took over the Fatah. Hamas is using dozens or hundreds or maybe more than thousands of charitable society in order to help the population. In the name of Allah, in the name of Islam, Hamas, but Fatah is now part of the regime. Fatah is now part of the power, part of the government. And they are now blaming to be corrupted. They left the people behind. And this is this is the main reason of the angry against Abu Mazen and his people. Now, Abu Mazen saw a good opportunity to send back the Fatah to be part of the people, the popular movement. But I think it was the second or the third day of the coronavirus, Abu Mazen took a decision to reshape the Fatah by groups called the Emergency Committees. Emergency Committees is nickname or alter ego of the Fatah groups. Now, the official reason or the official task of those committees is to help the people, like a volunteers group in Canada, in USA, in Italy. But there are something behind those official tasks. And I will tell you one by one. First one, Abu Mazen uses those committees in order to work in areas called C, in the places they that his security forces unallowed to be there. And we can see now more than 400 committees of the Fatah dealing or acting in Area C against the settlements. They closed more than 50 main roads between the settlements. They are hunting Palestinian workers in the Jordan Valley, in the agriculture area of the Jordan Valley, one for to destroy the agriculture in the Jordan Valley before Netanyahu will declare the Israeli sovereignty in the Jordan Valley, before Donald Trump before the deal of the century to be part of a reality. In East Jerusalem, place that Abu Mazen unallowed to be there, he has no sovereignty in East Jerusalem. The East Jerusalem, like the refugees, like the borders, this is part of the final agreement. After Oslo, there is something called the final agreement, but Abu Mazen is doing a lot in order to occupy Jerusalem from Israeli sovereignty by the Fatah and be there even before the final agreement. So those dozens of Fatah committees, they are now running the life of the population in the small villages in East Jerusalem. Something very important for you to know. Those committees of the Fatah, they are all, most of them, they are under the control of the intelligence of the Palestinian Authority, the equivalent of the Mossad. They call it the General Intelligence, heading by a colonel called Majed Faraj. Majed Faraj, it seems to be one of the people that will be after the day of Abu Mazen. He is claiming to be the head of the PLO or the head of the PA. And those Fatah committees in East Jerusalem is part of his, this is part of the base of his power, of his political power for the day after Abu Mazen. Why did he do it? Because during the coronavirus, the head of the Palestinian government, Mohammad Shtaye, he appears like the new, someone from Ramallah told me, Baruch, you know, this is the same like Rudy Giuliani in New York after the 9/11, after the massive disaster. Now this is this Mohammad Shtaye, he is the one that charge on the combat against the coronavirus. And he is doing a very, very good job by the assistance of Israel. But he is the head of the, what we call the incitement group of the Palestinian people. He uses the incitement in order to get the image of very extremist figure against the occupation and against Israel. This Majed Faraj from the intelligence of the Palestinian Authority, he is This is one of the conflicts, the internal conflicts of the Fatah, one against the other, and he decided to act against the popularity of Shtaye by the establishing of the Hamas groups. So this is a very good example for you to know that how the internal conflicts, the internal rivals in the Palestinian Authority affect Israel, and seems to be on the CNN or in the New York Times, like the Israel avoid some volunteers, Palestinian young groups in East Jerusalem. Nonsense. This is part of the terror of the future conflict using by the Palestinian people. So here now in the slide, you can see some block on the main road between Jerusalem and Ramallah. And on the other, you can see the unit called 101. This is the special unit of the Palestinian army. They sent by the Palestinian Authority for the first time. For the first time, they were sent from Jericho to East Jerusalem to be there for many days in order to control the violence by those committees of the Fatah. Because those committees of the Fatah, they are based on the Tanzim of the Fatah. They are based on the Shabiba, the youth movement of the Fatah. But also they are based on some local militias of the Fatah. They are very, very, very violent people. They killed Palestinian in Nablus. They killed another one in Jericho. They killed third one in Hebron. A legal forum of lawyers of in the Palestinian Authority now demand Abu Mazen to stop their illegal acts in the Palestinian Authority. But in East Jerusalem, Abu Mazen led them to do the job because this is because they have some political aims or targets against Israel. Hannah, next slide, maybe. Okay. Let's talk about the Palestinian workers. There are more than 135,000 Palestinian workers inside Israel or in the Israeli settlements in the West, in Judea and Samaria. And many of them by permits, others without permits, but those 135,000 of people, the income from the Israeli market is 66% of the Palestinian income. If they're not allowed to go to Israel or are not allowed to go to the settlements, Palestinians will lose 66% of the yearly income. Now, Israel allowed the Palestinian workers to stay in Israel, not to go every day back to their houses, to their homes in the West Bank, in Judea and Samaria, but also to stay in Israel. It's a very difficult some to do because many of them involved in terror, many of them involved in crime, in criminal background, but Israel took the decision to let them stay for many weeks in Israel. Now, as well, Israel let them to stay in the settlements, in Barkan, close to Ariel, in Mishor Edomim, close to Maale Edomim, in order to be there and to work. Israel let them to stay in the agriculture areas in the Jordan Valley, all in order to let them to get the salaries and to let the Palestinian income to stay stable. But this Muhammad Shtaye, the prime minister, and those committees of the Fatah, as well as Hamas and other terror groups, they are now hunting the workers in the settlements because they want to caused damage to the Israeli market, to the Israeli economy, and to destroy the Israeli agriculture in the Jordan Valley. How they do it? Two main ways. One, as I told you before, using the committees of the Fatah to, I have no other words, but to hunt those workers. You can see a workers from Beitar going to Beit Lechem on the in the evening after 9 hours of work, and they will be hunted by the Palestinian services, getting inside a car and go to the jail in Hebron or the jail in Jericho. But the second way to avoid the Palestinian workers from the settlements is to use the demonization against the settlers. This Muhammad Shtaye, he said that the settlers are nothing but the incubation of the coronavirus, that the Zionism are the same as the virus, the coronavirus, okay? You don't need Joseph Goebbels to come back. You can hear to this Shtaye in order to hear those sentences. They describe the settlers as the, blame the settlers to use the coronavirus in order to infect Palestinians and send them back to Nablus or to Ramallah in order to cause a damage to the population. This is what they say. This is the ethnic cleaning, or this is the biological war by Israeli against Palestinian. You can now go through the media, through the social media, and you can see millions of stories about how my brother, how my uncle went to a settlement in order to work, and those Jews with their long nose and with the beard forced him to build a new hospital for the Israeli coronavirus sick people. We have no hospital or no center to host those sick people in the settlements, only in Tel Aviv, in Jerusalem, in Haifa, in Bat Yam, but Palestinian succeed to convince the people that we took those Palestinian from Nablus in order to infect them and to let them work to do the dirty job instead of those Jews that are fear for their life. So this is something that is now going here. But I ask my sources in Ramallah, guys, are you crazy? You know that if those workers will not go to Israel or to the settlements, you will lose 66% of your income. One of a million times that Palestinians prefer the nationalism aims on what we call the social, the life interest.
They put it ahead of their humanitarian issues and ahead of their people.
Right. The priority is to fight Israel and not to let those people to get a salary. By Derech Agav, the salary in Israel and in the West, in the settlements is five times higher than the daily salary in the Palestinian Authority, and seven times higher than the work in the sector private in the Palestinian territory. So this is another way to show you how the Palestinians reshape the relationships between them and us in order to face the next conflict. Another slide, Hannah, please. Fatah Emergency Committee, okay. Okay, I told you about the act of those people, of those Fatah committees in the settlements or in East Jerusalem. Let me tell you something about some scenarios that I think that we are going to face. Only in the case of massive outbreak of the virus. The people of Hamas from Gaza, like Yihya Sinwar, like Khalil El Khaye, or the head of the Islamic Jihad, Ziyad Nakhale, they declare in front of the cameras, okay? You don't need to be intelligence one in order to know it. They say, the minute that our people will not have the right or the ability to breathe, Linshom, 6 million of Israelis will not have the ability to breathe. Okay,
why is he saying to breathe? To breathe.
Yeah. Okay, why this Sinwar, Yihya Sinwar, the head of the Hamas in Gaza, used the number 6 million of those Israeli people will not have the right or the ability to breathe? Because it was 4 or 5 days because the Holocaust day in Israel, and they know how to use the sensitive motive of Israeli people in order to threat the Israeli population. In Gaza so far, because of the closure, there are less than 20 cases of corona infected. Hamas is doing a lot in order to avoid it. They now built more than 1,000 rooms of isolation centers. They use some hotels in Gaza as isolation areas, and they close the borders. They not let them, even in the Ramadan, to open the mosques or the schools or the universities, but they know very well that there is a huge possibility to face massive infected, and we know now that Hamas is froze the struggle against Israel. As a Deir al-Qassam, the military wing of the Hamas is now dealing with the closure, with the internal closure, but we know that the minute that there will be they know that they cannot avoid it, I think they will launch a missiles again against Israel in order to get some medical aid. Number two, I will not be surprised if we'll see dozens, hundreds of people from Ramallah, from Beit Lechem, from Jericho, going marching to the settlements, to Ofra, to Male Adumim, to the borders, to the Israeli blocks between Israel and the West Bank, in order to seek for help, or in order to be away from the Palestinian Authority, because we have some indications that maybe internal protesting march will. יפעלו שתהיה מחאה פנימית נגד הרשות הפלסטינית.
There'll be internal protest against the Palestinian Authority.
וקריסה של מערכת הבריאות והכלכלה.
Which will cause complete failure and shutdown of the health and economic situation.
And then Palestinian civilians will seek help from the Israeli official forces, IDF, settlers, and some others.
הם רוצים שאתה תסיים בתוך 5 דקות משהו.
אני מסיים. זו בדיוק הנקודה. עכשיו, many of people said in the beginning of the crisis that this very good opportunity to reopen or to renew the political negotiation between Israel and Palestinians. I told my colleagues for the first day, Nonsense. This not. The Minister of the Health in the Palestinian Authority, she said, we are not coordinating with the Israelis. This is the Israeli interest. We are helping them and not they are not helping us. Some other people in Ramallah, they say, okay, look, Baruch, we will not sit again with you or with the Americans for negotiation unless Donald Trump will declare that he will take back the deal of the century. And they got shocked because Netanyahu won the last election. They are now in shock because Benny Gantz is going with Netanyahu to what we call a unit government. And they are in shock because of the fail of the Arab parties in Israel to be part of the coalition. So a very higher official in Ramallah told me, if the coronavirus would met us in some other circumstances, political circumstances, yes, we will use it as a bridge to renew the negotiation. But now we will prefer to continue with the political crisis, and the corona crisis will not change our nationalism or our political demands. So Israel will help them, they will be helped by the Israel, they will continue with the incitement, they will send the Fatah to Jerusalem, they will avoid people in going to work in Israel and in the settlements and in the Jordan Valley, but they know that Israel will not let them to collapse.
I think we're ready for the question and answer period when the ZOA would like to start that.
We have a huge amount of questions. And candidly, we typically would invite people to raise their hands and ask questions. But I got a huge amount of questions here. People kind enough to spend time typing. So thank you, of course, Baruch. That was very, very interesting and informative. I want to ask you, if you don't mind, I'll give you the questions. We'll go through them one at a time. And I apologize when I get through as many as I can. If there are others that want to pipe up, that's fine. So Len Getz, one of our board members, asks, you mentioned Israel does not consider the Palestinian Authority a terrorist organization. However, the PA continues to incite terrorist activities in their media, in the mosques, their speeches, and their schools. But most significantly, they continue to pay terrorists and families to kill Jews. Is there any thought in the Israeli government to designate the PA a terrorist organization, since it's clear they engage in terrorist activities?
Very good one. I don't think so, because the meaning is the end of the Palestinian Authority, because the head of the Fatah is Abu Mazen, because the head of the incitement is the Prime Minister of Palestinian Authority. This is very, very good question, because I think that Israel is so far doesn't know or didn't define the full meaning of what terror is. Okay, terror is giving money. And you know Nitzana Darshan Leitner. Yesterday, Israel took a decision to take 450 million shekels from the Palestinian budget and give it back to the families hurt by terror. But So far, Israel, I think, defined terror defined incitement not as a part of terror. I think this is something we should work on it for the next, maybe next generation. Yesterday, the popular front, Hachazit Amamit, the popular front, which is part of the PLO, this is the second movement in the PLO, yesterday they declared that Abu Mazen dried the source of the money of the popular front in order to force them to stop the military activities against Israel. These are the people that killed Rina Schnerb 6 months ago in Ma'ayan Dani, close to Ramallah. So now you can see that part of the PLO is terror group, like the Popular Front. Part of the Fatah are terror group in Gaza. Whether Israel will declare on the Fatah as a terror or will consider incitement is terror, this is the minute that Abu Mazen should shut down the Palestinian Authority.
Okay, this is great. We're getting questions all over the place. Let me read you the next one. Sharon Frisch. Why don't Palestinians expect the PLO? Oops, the question just disappeared. Let me pull it back up. Why don't Palestinians expect the PLO to supply what is needed to combat corona? I know you discussed some of this, but why do they expect their enemy Israel? This is really, I think, again, if you could focus this a little bit. Why do they expect their enemy Israel to send them supplies and medications? And then she concludes, what chutzpah, which I happen to agree with her. But if you could...
Very good. First of all, Hamas declared, and the people of Hamasin declared that Gaza Strip and the West Bank, as much as they are not an independent state, they are under the influence, under the control of the Israeli government. Israel is responsible for them. Even Gaza, after the Israel withdrawal from Gaza 2005, they said, no, you are controlling our area. They are not saying the same to the Egyptian from the east of the Gaza. Now, I think that Israel faced some law or some international aspects of what is helping the Palestinians and what is not should be helping. But as much as I know, Israel wants the Palestinian Authority, the PA, to stay, to be stable as a civil system, to deal the life of the 2 million of Palestinian people over there, because the alternative that the Israeli soldier, like I was 32 years ago, will have to run the civil life of the population. I can tell you that in Ramallah, they know, they say, Mr. Netanyahu succeeded to force Abu Mazen to be the mayor, the biggest mayor of the what called the West Bank, and to use him only to run the life of the civilians. But from the other side, they do not expect PLO to give them the money. I can tell you a secret. 6 months ago, we did a research about the World Bank money giving to the Palestinian Authority from Britain and Austria and Netherlands. You know that money goes from the donations through the World Bank to the Palestinian Authority in Ramallah and go back to the PLO in Lebanon, in Jordan, in Egypt. So the donations, Europe, Britain, USA, they are giving money not to the Palestinian civilians, but other to the groups in the PLO. So this is something unbelievable, as well as the UNRWA.
Okay.
I just wanted to say, when he's saying UNRWA, we're talking about the UN, the UN committee there. Okay, go ahead.
Okay. Yes, so let me go through a couple other questions. Really, there's some great questions here. There was a question someone asked about Jordan that comes from Joseph Flashner. How come Jordan is off the hook? Shouldn't they take these Palestinians in? And then after you answer that, I want to ask you some assertion of sovereignty questions.
Say it one more time.
Why is Jordan off the hook? Why shouldn't Jordan take these Palestinians in?
Haim Yalden en lahem eizeshu achayut ala al ha'am hazeh.
Very good. 1988, 1988, a year after the first intifada, King Hussein declared the disengagement between Jordan and the West Bank. And he left only the responsibility to Har HaBayit, to the Temple Mount. But he cut the responsibility of the Jordanian to Palestinian, number one. Number two, more than 70% of the Jordan population are Palestinian. The minute that King Abdullah will combine those two sides of the Jordan River and will get them into his country, there will not any more Jordanian people. You know, and I can remember the first day of King Abdullah when he was chosen to be the next king, and the newspaper in Jordan said, this is our last king. This is our last king because of the threats of the Palestinian, not only on the West Bank, but in the West Bank. Two years ago, maybe a little more, about a million of Palestinians, half of them in the south of Hebron and half of them in the south of the Jordan, declared to be one civil unit. This is very good indication that the tribes, you know, Palestinian, this is very tribe society, how the tribes, especially in the south, in Hebron and in Jordan, they rejected from the first day the PLO when we let them go to Israel to come in. I was on duty that time, and those head of the tribes, they told me, are you crazy? This is import leadership. This is not the nature leadership of the Palestinian people.
Please. Okay. Let me, I want to go through some annexation questions or assertion of sovereignty questions, and then someone asked a very interesting question about TPA, which we may then use as a transition to you, Ochana, talking a little bit about TPA. So on the assertion of sovereignty issue, Bruce Weingart actually asked a number of questions, so I'm going to actually read all of them so that you can pick and choose from the questions you want. It's all kind of the same point, but he asked a very good question. Bruce asks, what percentage of Yehuda Shomron, Judea Samaria, does the assertion of sovereignty or annexation represent? Will this be an impediment to a two-state solution? If yes, why? If not, why not? And again, the ZOA is not a proponent of a two-state solution, but I'm just repeating the question. The next question he asks, the Arab League has just called an emergency meeting to address this impending move by Israel. How does Israel interpret this? What about the statement of condemnation on Friday that was issued by the EU? There are a couple more, but that's the drift. If you can talk about assertion of sovereignty, some people call it annexation, ZOA calls it assertion of sovereignty. If you could talk about that and some of the elements, how much land, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay, so far, I haven't seen the map that Mr. Netanyahu said it was drawn by a special team from Israel and USA. I haven't saw the map, so I cannot tell you. But if I understood the idea of what we call the sovereignty of the Israeli Jordan Valley, or even in the sea areas, I think it will take under the Israeli sovereignty less than 60,000 people of Palestinian, but more than 80% of the area. So the main idea is to took the maximum area, maximum territories, and the minimum population. And the number is less than 50,000, but more than 80%. If you want to speak, to talk only about the West Bank, only the Jordan Valley, so the Palestinian population in the Jordan Valley is less than 10,000, but the territory of the Jordan Valley is more than half of the all the West Bank, of all the Area C. So the logic of the Israeli meaning is to spread our sovereignty on territory, but not on population. But in during the last 3 or 4 years, I think that more than 75% of the Palestinian people acknowledge that there is no chance to what we call the two-state solution. This is something very, 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 very far from us. But many of them said that we would like to be like the people in the East Jerusalem. The Palestinian in East Jerusalem, they have the same idea that me and Hannah have, but they only cannot vote to the Knesset. And the Palestinian in the West Bank now say, we want the same life of our brothers in the East Jerusalem. Later, we will fight about the rights of voting. But first of all, let us to be part of the Israeli regime. After that Israel finished to build the security wall, more than 250,000 Palestinians went from the Palestinian side of the wall to the Israeli side on the wall. It was illegal ways, but in order to be on the safe side. Now, but let me give you a very important note about what you said, two-state solution. Look at this. And this is something that I'm very, very angry about, the English media and the Hebrew media.
ZOA is not...
I know. Yeah, sure. I'm not talking to the family here. I just want you to know. Right. Look at this.
Okay.
When Abu Mazen said, Daulatain la Sha'abain, two states solution, he doesn't say two states for two people. No, he only said in Arabic two states. That's nothing more. But it always translated in Hebrew media that he said shtei medinot leshnei ha'amim, two states for two people. No, he in his words, in his lips, he didn't mention two people. But in some cases that he was asked about what you mean, he said, one state to the Palestinian people, and the other states are for Israeli, not for a Jew people. Means that our refugees in Haifa, in Jaffa, in Akko can come in. So he didn't recognize the Judaism of the two-state solution. Okay? Sometimes in... Please, okay.
Okay. So-